96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning. The passport office will accept applications of those impacted by that citizenship ruling. The cruise tax adjustment delayed to January 2024. And the man who brutally attacked his daughter's mom takes a plea deal. It's all straight ahead this morning. I'm Dwight Strawn, and this is Morning Blend.
Wake up. It's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of a new way. You know that it's the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up.
Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Friday, June 23rd, 2023. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Laverne Gardner will be here filling in for Stephen Hanna. Also, this morning is part two of our Municipal Government Week. Today, we are looking at the system that Canada has, their multi-tiered system with a federal, provincial, and municipal government, and how that works and who does what. That's coming up. And later in business, we're talking about the Nassau Cruise Port again, as they are now open or will be open to the public. That's all straight ahead. But first, it's time for the overnight, the latest breaking news from while you were sleeping, and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs announcing that the Passport Office will, on Monday, accept the applications of people impacted by a recent Privy Council ruling that under Article 6 of the Bahamas Constitution, all children born in the Bahamas out of wedlock to a Bahamian father and a foreign mother are Bahamians at birth. The Ministry says the new policy will affect people whose father is a citizen of the Bahamas and his name appears on the applicant's birth certificate. The Ministry says it's working closely with the Office of the Attorney General and will further advise the public on any amendments or procedural changes regarding the issuance of travel documents as a result of that Privy Council ruling. On Tuesday, Attorney General Ryan Pinder indicated that for individuals whose father's name is on their birth certificate, the Passport Office is free to begin processing their applications for passports. He said what now needs to be finalized is proof of paternity in matters where the father's name is not on the birth certificate. Days after Carnival Cruise Line President Christine Duffy called for a delay in the government's recently announced departure tax increases for the cruise industry, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Tourism Chester Cooper saying the policy will be implemented in January of next year instead of July, as in next month. Earlier this month, Prime Minister Davis, Philip Davis, said that 95% of new government revenue would come from non-Bahamians, as he announced an adjustment in the departure tax for cruise visitors from $18 to $23 for departures from Nassau, Freeport, and Bimini, and $25 from other islands, as well as a tax of $35 from departures from a private island. The teen who claimed he was acting in self-defense when he stabbed a schoolmate in the back during a lunchtime brawl at Anatole Rogers High School has been convicted of murder. The 9-member jury deliberated for 30 minutes yesterday before returning a verdict of guilty with a count of 7-2. Most of the jurors accepted the prosecution's contention that the 15-year-old stabbed an innocent bystander in the back on September 12, 2022. During his testimony, the teenager said that he took a knife to the school for his protection because he had received threats via Facebook. While on the lunch line, the teen said he was confronted by another student. He said he walked away from the initial confrontation. However, he was punched and pushed to the ground. Once on the ground, the teenager said that he was stomped and kicked by at least 4 other students. When his attackers ran, the teen, who was 14 years old, stabbed another 14-year-old in the back, breaking the handle off the knife. Under cross-examination, the accused admitted that after viewing video footage of the incident, that the student whom he stabbed had not attacked him. However, he said that at the time he believed he was with the attackers. And a man who attacked his estranged girlfriend while she held their infant daughter took a plea deal on Thursday. Ray Sands pleaded guilty to attempted murder and exposing a child to grievous harm when he appeared before Senior Justice Bernard Turner. He received concurrent sentences of 15 years and 4 years in prison. Sands has already spent 1 year and 7 months in custody because he was not granted bail. Prosecutors say that on November 15, 2021, Sands went to Petra Curry's Key West Street home to see their daughter. He attacked Curry after she rebuffed his attempts at reconciliation. Sands headbutted Curry and stabbed her about the body while he held their daughter, while she held their daughter. Onlookers intervened and stopped the initial attack and took the child into the home. However, Sands returned and knocked Curry down with his car and ran over her as she lay on the ground. Curry has partially recovered from the brutal attack, but she's in need of surgery to repair her back. Sands remained unrepentant, said that Curry had ruined his life. The judge told Sands that he thought he would have availed himself of the opportunity to apologize to Curry. He said that Curry was not in any way responsible for the events of that day. Turner said that Curry was left to raise their child while recovering for the rest of their life. Outside court, Sands once again told Curry that she had ruined his life. Overseas, at least 31 people believed to have died in a gas explosion in a disused mine in South Africa that happened last month but is now only coming to light. The suspected illegal miners were believed to have been killed on May 18th, and most of their bodies are still underground, according to South Africa's Department of Mineral Resources and Energy. Authorities were being prevented from sending a search team into the mine to retrieve bodies because there were still dangerously high levels of methane gas in the shaft. The department says it was considering various options to speedily deal with what was a, quote, unique and strange situation. Illegal prospecting is rife in South Africa's old gold mining areas, where miners go into closed and often dangerous mine shafts to dig for deposits. The government department said it had received information that 3 bodies had been recovered after they were brought to the surface by other illegal miners. Another 16 suspected illegal miners were also in the shaft. They've handed themselves over to authorities. Authorities say they believe the miners are nationals from neighboring Lesotho. Lesotho's foreign ministry recently passed information onto South African authorities on the incident. In sports, Bahamas able to pull out the win against Honduras in their final group match of the Davis Cup action, and the America's Group 3, the win meaning they avoided their fourth consecutive loss of the tournament and give themselves a chance to at least remain in Group 3. Playing at the Club Internacional de Tennis in Paraguay, the Bahamas took care of Honduras 3-0. The matches are being played on outdoor clay courts. The win gives the Bahamas a 1-3 win-loss record in the tournament. You can read about how they did in today's Guardian Sports section. And from the NBA, draft overnight, and Victor Wembanyama, you better learn how to pronounce that name, the presumed number one pick for months, the rare certainty in an NBA draft process that's often a guessing game, and he certainly was the number one draft pick. The San Antonio Spurs are confident he will be worth the wait. The Spurs took the 19-year-old from France, who arrives with enormous expectations to become basketball's newest sensation Thursday night, triggering chants of Wemby, Wemby, from a group of Spurs fans waving signs from the first row of seats in Barclays Center in Brooklyn. Wembanyama comes with far more height and hype than most number one picks. Listed at 7'4", he dominated his French league in his final season there, leading all players in scoring, rebounding, and blocked shots. Now he makes a move to the NBA, perhaps the best prospect since LeBron James came out of the high school system in 2003. Wemby brings a package of skills that seem perfect for the modern NBA and too vast for one player, with the size of a center and the shooting and ball-handling ability of a guard. And some big trade news in the NBA as well. Chris Paul's pursuit of an NBA championship, taking him to the Golden State Warriors after they agreed to the framework of a trade Thursday that will send Jordan Poole to the Washington Wizards. The trade also includes a package of draft, according to the person who spoke to the Associated Press on condition of anonymity, as the trade has not been finalized or approved by the NBA. ESPN first reported on the agreement. Paul, saying that he was excited, also said that he's already talked to Warriors star Stephen Curry. The Wizards agreed to acquire Paul from Phoenix last week in the deal that sent Bradley Beal from Washington to the Suns. Paul had two of his title hope seasons thwarted by the Warriors. In 2018, Paul and the Houston Rockets had a 3-2 series lead in the Western Conference Finals before he got hurt, missed the final two games, and Golden State prevailed on the way to the NBA title. And in 2019, the Warriors beat Paul and the Rockets again, that time in the West semifinals before ultimately falling to Toronto in the NBA Finals. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather. Your first look at weather brought to you by Nescafe Coffee. We've got a lot going on weather-wise, including in the tropics. But closer to home, tropical moisture will continue to stream across the islands and enhance occasional bouts of shower activity in the Bahamas. Meanwhile, a surface ridge will build across the area and generate moderate to fresh breezes, mainly over the central and southeastern Bahamas. Mariners and beachgoers should be alert for possible waterspout activity, and there's a chance of localized flooding in low-lying and flood-prone areas during heavy and or prolonged rainfall events. And everybody's still being advised to remain hydrated and limit outdoor activities, as heat indices will reach the triple digits again today. For the Northwest Bahamas, your forecast calls for partly cloudy and very warm conditions, widely scattered showers, isolated thunderstorms that'll continue through tonight. Expect gusty winds and higher seas in or near showers and thunderstorms. Winds east to southeast at 10 to 15 knots, seas 2 to 4 feet. For the central and southeast Bahamas, partly cloudy, hot, breezy, and a bit hazy, with widely scattered showers and a few possible thunderstorms through tonight. Small craft caution remains in effect. Expect gusty winds and higher seas in or near heavy showers and thunderstorms. Winds east to southeast at 15 to 20 knots, seas 4 to 7 feet. Temperature-wise today, highs getting up to around 90 Fahrenheit, 32 Celsius. But the heat index will make it feel like it's 104 Fahrenheit, 40 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 75 Fahrenheit, 24 Celsius. That's your first look at weather this morning. We'll have your extended outlook coming up after traffic in just a bit. This weather check brought to you by Nescafe Coffee. Elevate your coffee experience with Nescafe Gold.
Wake up today. Wake up.
It's time for a break, but when we come back, we're discussing the day's top stories right here on Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Your home for fresh news and smart talk all day.
Experience that awakens your senses with Nescafe Gold. Premium Arabica coffee beans, carefully selected, roasted to perfection and finely ground, resulting in a unique and unmatched flavor and aroma that captivates the senses. Enticing aroma, smooth taste, elevate your coffee experience with Nescafe Gold.
I'm Lasagna Mizek, Managing Director of RBC Royal Bank Bahamas, with some big news that will elevate your debit card experience. RBC's new Visa debit chip card will soon be here. To make things easier for you, we're offering free FedEx delivery when you validate your contact details. No need to wait in line. We'll bring the card straight to you. Call 356-8500. Select option 7 for Visa debit direct line and update your delivery address. Our team is available weekdays between 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Take advantage of the security and convenience of chip and PIN technology. Free delivery is for a limited time, so act now.
With over 25 years in business, nothing says commitment to our people, culture, and service like Rev. And this year is no different. We will continue to elevate your home experience for you to create and share memories for years to come, while keeping you connected to the people and things you love most. Our pledge to provide quality service each year remains true. Rev is made for you.
The Access Accelerator Small Business Development Center is here to help small businesses throughout the entire Bahamas. To better serve you, we've made it easier to contact us. Call 461-7232, WhatsApp 359-0626 or 359-2394, email helpdesk at sbdcbahamas.com, or submit a ticket when you visit our help center at accessaccelerator.org. The Access Accelerator, empowering small business.
Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Street, has those hard-to-find fasteners for you right now. You can find stainless steel regular hex, carriage bolts, galvanized bolts, threaded rods, nails, self-tap screws, sex bolts, anchor bolts, turnbuckles, masonry tools, hand tools, and weed whacker strings. Check out the rope selection and car body fasteners too. Special orders are welcome. It's your number one fastener store. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Streets. Call 326-1976.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
The 50th Independence Secretariat invites you to celebrate 50 and get your praise on at the Sound of Jubilee National Gospel Concert, Sunday, June 25th, 6 p.m. at Bahamas Faith Ministries.
One God, one people.
Dressed to represent in your national colors.
Hi!
This event is absolutely free. Give God the glory and celebrate 50. It's the Sound of Jubilee National Gospel Concert, this Sunday, June 25th, 6 p.m. at Bahamas Faith Ministries.
At Wendy's, we are different. We don't just use beef. It's fresh, never frozen. Our burgers are square because we never cut corners. Served hot off the grill with fresh lettuce, tomatoes, onions, and American cheese. We believe in fast food done right. Always serving fresh, never frozen beef. Order a hot, juicy Dave single, double, or triple. Made with fresh, never frozen beef. Now only at Wendy's. Different inside and out.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of a new way. You know that this is the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at Morning Blend 969 or facebook.com/morningblend969. Text us 4224796, standard text rate supply. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn. Stephen Hanna is off today. Joining us, Laverne Gardner again. Good morning, Laverne. 2 days in a row. We are very blessed.
Good morning. I'm blessed to be here again with you.
It's our pleasure. Definitely. A lot to get to this morning. It's part two of our Municipal Government Week. Yesterday, we went through the recommendations of the 2019 Local Government for New Providence Committee. And today, we're going to look at Canada and the system they have there. Also a member of the Commonwealth, also a parliamentary democracy, and has the British monarch as their head of state and a prime minister. Similar system to ours, but they have differentiated their government. So they have multi-tiers, multi-layers. So they have a federal system, provincial system, municipal system. And I don't think anybody there says, but we'll find out from our guest today, that they have too much government. I don't think that's how it works. But we'll hear how they do it. And if that's something we need to be looking at as well to better manage what we're doing here. So that's coming up this morning and later in business. Nassau Cruise Port, we were there for the opening day, and now they're opening to the public, and we're going to get details about that, what we can expect there. So a lot to get to on this Friday. Let's begin, though, with what else is in the news. And in the news, big headline in the Nassau Guardian, the Commissioner of Police, zero tolerance for crime downtown. He was speaking at the ceremony yesterday for officers. The new officers will be joining the force. 100 officers trained in international port security as well, we're told. And he stressed that the country's tourism product must be protected and that the force will have a zero tolerance approach. Fernando speaking during the passing out parade for 229 new recruits in Rawson Square. 18 recruits from the Turks and Caicos Islands also graduated yesterday. So he's echoing here what Deputy Prime Minister Chester Cooper spoke about in the House earlier in the week about zero tolerance, and apparently that offended some people. Did you hear about that, Laverne? People were upset. Some that that the Deputy Prime Minister called out certain people who weren't going to be welcome downtown. Generally,
I still can't figure out what the offense was about. I think that people just want to be offended.
Yeah, I think they like it. Yes.
But yeah.
Prostitutes have feelings too.
I mean, if you don't fall into that category.
Well, maybe that's the issue. Maybe a whole
I don't see what a lot the of people, offense was.
A whole heck of a lot of people probably do. So maybe that's it. But anyway, so that's what the commissioner is saying. Well, we've heard these things before. We hope that is the case. Let's see. We'll see. We'll see. But congratulations to all the officers who passed out. We hope that you will do the very best to maintain the integrity of the force and even elevate it, right, to new heights. All right. So this is some good news for some folks who were feeling that they were in limbo still and very confused, but the Ministry of Foreign Affairs announced yesterday that the passport office will, on Monday, begin accepting the applications of people impacted by the Privy Council ruling about the Constitution, and that children born out of wedlock to Bahamian fathers and foreign mothers in the Bahamas are indeed Bahamian at birth, and as long as you have a birth certificate with the Bahamian man as your father on the birth certificate, you should have no issue beginning Monday, and you should be able to get your documents sorted out. So that is going to be a relief. The ministry says it's still working with the Office of the Attorney General to figure out how it's going to deal with those whose father is not on the birth certificate and how they will determine paternity. And that may take a little bit longer. But at least that is one hurdle that has been cleared. Yeah. We may talk about this a little bit later in business, but we spoke about this earlier in the week. The cruise lines were making an appeal to the government to push back the increase of departure tax, give them more time, they were saying, because July is right here, and it is not enough time for them. And so the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Tourism has agreed to push that back to January, that departure tax increase.
I'm confused, Dwight.
Yeah?
Why? Yeah, because I thought there were no new taxes and no increased taxes.
Well, there's an interesting paragraph here in this story. Earlier this month, Prime Minister Philip Davis said 95% of new government revenue would come from non-Bahamians as he announced an adjustment in the departure tax. So this was for, you know, cruise passengers. Mm-hmm.
Doesn't it impact us as well?
If you're on a cruise, I guess.
Only on a cruise? So if you're flying out of here, you're not going to pay any increased departure tax? Is that what you're saying?
It's a departure tax for cruise visitors from $18 to $23.
I understand that, but I'm asking you because, I mean, and I was trying to go over the budget. I don't think it made a distinction. So I'm just trying to be clear. If I book a flight, whether it's next month or it is it's next year, January, am I going to pay an increase on the departure tax?
As far as I see, it's only a cruise departure tax.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So if you're sailing out of Nassau, Freeport, and Bimini.
Okay.
Correct me if I'm wrong, folks, if I'm missing the part there. But that was for cruises. For cruises. Now, we'll see. We'll see. We'll get that sorted out. But a cruise departure tax. But Bahamians do that as well. Bahamians do sail. And so it will be affecting them as well. Yeah? But, hey, January, not July. Along with that $2 tourism enhancement fee that goes into effect in January. Yeah, let's see. Let's read this article here by our Paige McCartney in Guardian Business. Duffy recently, this is Christine Duffy, the CEO and president of Carnival Cruise Lines. Duffy recently said the change would be particularly challenging for the cruise line's budget travelers. Cooper told reporters yesterday that the government is moving ahead with its plan despite the objection. He said, quote, nobody wants their taxes to increase. They've made certain representations. We've taken those into consideration. The Prime Minister and I have spoken, and we will speak at the cabinet level. One of the issues was that they wanted to be able to recapture all the taxes from their customers, etc. I won't go into details in terms of what their representations were. Suffice it to say that we have already given a 7-month delay in the implementation of the tax. The tax does not go into force until January 2024. That's a 7-month notice period. I don't have anything else to say at this point except that they are important partners, as are all of our stakeholders in the cruise business, but our taxes are essential to build roads, schools, and docks, and to revitalize Bay Street. We would all prefer to be no taxes, but we all want government services. In addition to the departure tax adjustment, the Prime Minister also announced the introduction of a new tourism environmental levy of $5 for each cruise visitor and a $2 levy for tourism enhancement. He said the $2 levy would go into a special fund, not the consolidated fund. The announcement of the increasing cruise departure tax comes just weeks after the grand opening of the $300 million NASA cruise port. Okay, yeah. But as far as I know, it's a cruise departure tax. So for now, if you're just flying out, Laverne, I think you'll be okay. For now. Can't tell you what's going to happen next year.
Okay.
Right. All right. Let's get your reaction to that, folks. The delay is that that seems reasonable, right? I mean, that was he just announced that last month, and here, bam, you have a month to get ready for it. January. What do you make of it? 323-6232. 325-431. 325-4259. Call us toll free, 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Caller, good morning. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Call us toll free, 242-300-5720. Yeah. All right. This person says, I had the same question as Laverne, but since the Prime Minister said 95% of the tax is from non-Bahamians, I think he's speaking about the cruise passengers, to cruise passengers. Yeah. Well, in this regard. Mm-hmm. Mm. Sure. Yeah. Do you feel any particular way about that, though, Laverne, about the increase in the tax for cruise passengers? The cruise lines just getting back on their feet as well. And what Christine Duffy is saying about impacting budget. What do you make of that?
I don't have a particular feeling about it. You know, it's something I guess we have to do. It's when cruise lines make their decisions, they make decisions that's in the best interest for them, right? Mm. And this is just a part of it.
Yeah.
So.
Indeed. Yeah.
Well, I don't, like, I'm not like, oh, why are they doing this? Oh, the blah, blah, blah. No, none of that. I don't have any kind of feeling about it. It's happened, and they'll have to make the adjustment. They asked for the extension, and they got the extension.
Hmm.
So, what else is there to say?
Right. Okay.
All right. I'm sorry.
No.
Should I be more up in arms about it?
Not at all. That is, it is what it is. I think that's the best time to use that horrible saying.
Honestly, I didn't want to say it because I got say it, but no, I don't. And I don't believe that this increase, what is it, like a $5 increase?
Well, if you add up all of them, it could be a little more than $5.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because there's the $2 as well.
Yeah, there's a special $5. Right? There's a special $5 fee and $2
and
fee.
And a $2 plus one.
The other ones go about $4, 18, 19, okay. 22.
So whatever it is. It's maybe about 10. Can 10, we say $10?
10 to 12. $10 to $12.
Yeah, yeah. $10 to $12. Mm-hmm. I do not, and of course I'm not in tourism. I don't have the numbers, but I don't see that $10 to $12 impacting a traveler's, a cruise person's decision of whether or not as part of their cruise they're coming here.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't really foresee, you know, a big fallout.
Right. some text messages as we before we move on to another topic. This person says here, I don't understand. Okay, throw a rock into a pack of dogs. The ones who holler are the ones who got hit. This is related to the cruise lines, or is this about the prostitutes, drug peddlers, those type people? That's what you mean? I don't understand. All right. I think that's sufficient time, as it only applies to the cruise passengers. You mean the 7 month agreed upon recently delay is enough time, right? Okay, as opposed to less than 7 weeks. Sure. All right, I hear you. All right. Well, there we go. I guess it's going to be a little relief for everybody there. Sounds good. All right, so do you remember this story? This got all of us up in arms when it happened in November of 2021, was it? Yes. We saw that horrible footage of a woman holding her baby being run over by a man who everybody told us, hey, that's the baby's daddy right there. All right, so that matter finally getting resolved in court, and our TZ Davis writing about it. A man who attacked his estranged girlfriend while she held their infant daughter took a plea deal on Thursday. Ray Sands pleaded guilty to attempted murder and exposing a child to grievous harm. When he appeared before Senior Justice Bernard Turner, he received concurrent sentences. We like to do this, boy, concurrent. Of 15 years and 4 years in prison. Sands has already spent 1 year and 7 months in custody because he was not granted bail. Prosecutors say that on November 15th, 2021, Sands went to Patrick Curry's Key West Street home, ostensibly to see their daughter. He attacked Curry after she rebuffed his attempts at reconciliation. Sands headbutted Curry and stabbed her multiple times while she held their daughter. Onlookers intervened and stopped the initial attack and took the child into the home. However, Sands returned and knocked Curry down with his car and ran over her as she lay on the ground. Curry has partially recovered from the brutal attack, but she is in need of surgery to repair her back. Sands remained unrepentant, said that had ruined his life. The judge told Sands that he thought he should have availed himself of the opportunity to apologize to Curry. He said that Curry was not in any way responsible for the events of that day. The judge said that Curry was left to raise their child while recovering for the rest of her life. Outside of court, Sands once again told Curry that she had ruined his life. Still saying that, but he has been sentenced to 15 years and 4 years in prison to run concurrently. Mm.
So he's been sentenced to 15 years?
Essentially.
For attempted murder?
Mm-hmm. And causing exposing a child to grievous harm.
And exposing, and okay. Wow. And still, after all of that, he's still saying that she ruined his life. I'm concerned about that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm concerned about that. 15 years can go very quickly, Dwight.
I've almost been here 15 years. I'm about to, oh my God. Yeah.
Oh, Lord. Right. That's a lifetime. Oh, but seriously, and if this is still his attitude, you know, that's concerning.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm concerned for the young lady's safety.
Well,
I don't know. Maybe you have 15 years to reconsider.
Right.
But I'm just going based on his present attitude. This is your sentencing, and you are still blaming this victim.
Crazy stuff. Let's get some of your reaction in. We don't have to get too, right? Let's
We're just speaking generally now. Speaking, we don't have to get into
their private business. Yeah, if you know who they are,
I know them and blah,
right.
blah, blah, blah.
And we don't need to hear all that. You can keep that to yourself. But just in general, because there are many other women and men going through situations like this, exact same thing. And
a year.
Mm-hmm.
He's been in jail for a year with copious amounts of time to think to himself, I could have done this differently. I I allowed my emotions to take control of me. I whatever. And coming out of this, he still is looking at this person and saying, "You ruined my life."
Do you remember the video? Did you watch it?
I don't watch stuff like that.
Hmm. Right, that one was one.
I can't. It
that was one
me.
That I think everybody needed to watch, though. So that we could understand how human beings can get, that even someone who probably,
it was sufficient for me to read the story. No. I was horrified enough. I was like, I don't watch. Yeah. I don't like people to send me gruesome things, and I didn't want to see it.
Yeah, but in this regard, I think for people to understand that someone who probably does love you and claims they love you, for someone to act in this way, it really is very scary. And that I think people need to really understand what they're getting into when they get into relationships. How this can, all right? Oh, boy. Anyway, let's read these messages really quickly. Yeah, okay. This person says here, you mean 50 years, right? It can't be 15. This place is a joke. No, 15. 1-5. Bad verdicts, but interesting how the woman only got probation for throwing acid on another woman. I'm concerned about how the law isn't balanced with gender. Now,
all I'm going to say, Dwight, is you read the text.
I mean, they
you read it.
I mean, that's a terrible crime, right? But I mean, does that. Anyway, let me. I don't know what to say. That, and that's what you're going to sum it up to. The difference is because that was a woman and this was a man. Okay, all right. I blame some of these women who don't want the fathers to see their children. These women like to talk about the aftermath, but not the reasons. You can't deny a man from seeing his child. Well, I don't know if that was the situation here. Not too sure, but anyway. This texter says, I've been saying ad nauseum the law and the refusal to amend it is the problem with crime. 15 years for that heinous act? The word concurrent needs to be erased from the sentencing guidelines for judges. It is wicked, and God is not pleased. The Bahamas is weighed and found wanting. Okay. He actually has about 13 years or even less. Don't forget good behavior as well as, which is 8 months instead of 12, might be about 10. Boy. Yeah. There's another story in the paper today. This is a real tragedy. Also from Arteezy Davis, the teen who had claimed that he was acting self-defense when he stabbed a schoolmate in the back during a lunchtime brawl. He's been convicted of murder now. The child was, he's 14 years old. The 9-member jury deliberated for 30 minutes before returning a verdict with a count of 7-2. This is a real tragedy. Most of the jurors accepted the prosecution's contention that the 15-year-old stabbed an innocent bystander. He was 14 at the time. 15 now. He stabbed an innocent bystander in the back, killing him in September 12, 2022. Right? During his testimony, the teenager said that he took a knife to school for his protection because he had received threats via Facebook. While on the lunch line, he said that he was confronted by another student. As he walked away from the initial confrontation, he was punched and pushed to the ground. Once on the ground, the teenager said he was stomped and kicked by at least 4 other students. When his attackers ran, the teen, who was 14 years old at the time, stabbed another 14-year-old in the back, breaking the handle off the knife. Under cross-examination, the accused admitted after viewing video footage of the incident that the student whom he stabbed had not attacked him. However, he said at the time he believed that he was. Asked why he used a knife, the teen said it was the only way for him to defend himself against multiple attackers who were much bigger than he was. Justice Franklin Williams, KC, remanded the teen, who was on bail, pending his trial, into custody to await sentencing. Man. Multiple lives ruined there. Right?
Yeah. Sad.
Boy. Very, very sad. Oh, attempted murder. Oh, he didn't die. He didn't die? Oh, attempted. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Attempted. Yeah, sorry. This person says here, the man should have, this is back to the story, the man should have been given 20 years so that he could spend the full 15 years, because concurrently means the 4 years included is in the 15 years, so really he may only spend 10 or 11 years in prison. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, attempted murder. Okay. Attempted murder. Yes. Can you please bring awareness? There has not been any landline or cell phone service in North Andros for almost a week.
What?
Landline and cell. Well.
Wow.
All right, so ponder on all those things, folks. A lot going on, a lot that we have to deal with in this tiny place. It's disturbing. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to get into a lot more of these things and pick up Municipal Government Week. We're going to look at a different model, a different country, how they are doing things, how municipal government works there, and whether that is a model that the Bahamas could follow. That's coming up. This is Morning Blend on a Friday morning here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Stay with us. Talk to who you can see.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
That's the sound of your car or truck. That's the sound of your horn. Get in gear with an auto loan. RBC makes it easy to get your own.
Get in gear with an RBC auto loan with up to 100% financing, extended repayment, and low interest rates. Visit rbc.com/Caribbean/gearup. Conditions apply.
That's the sound of your car or truck. That's the sound of your horn. With an auto loan, RBC makes it easy to get your own.
Time for your first look at traffic for the morning, brought to you by RBC. Get in gear with an RBC auto loan in your real-time traffic this morning. Milo Butler Highway, not looking so bad this morning, but as you get just north of Harold Pond, if you're heading northbound, you'll see that heavy traffic for you heading toward the roundabout with Tonic Williams-Darling Highway. It's Tonic Williams-Darling Highway that's having issues this morning. Heavy traffic westbound to that roundabout with Milo Butler Highway. Over on Glasson Road, not looking so bad. About midway between Fire Trail and JFK Drive in the northbound lanes, you'll see heavy traffic there. And got some congestion westbound on Carmichael heading to Coral Harbor Road. Elsewhere, Blue Hill Road, just north of Soldier Road, looking busy for you getting, if you're heading northbound toward Independence Drive. And pockets along Robinson Road and Prince Charles Drive. But elsewhere, manageable so far this morning. That's your first look at traffic. Brought to you by RBC. Visit rbc.com/grip for an RBC auto loan. And time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by Pineapple Fest. We've got tropical moisture that will continue to stream across the area and enhance shower activity. Meanwhile, a surface ridge will build across the area and generate moderate to fresh breezes, mainly in the central and southeastern islands. For the Northwest Bahamas today, forecast calls for partly cloudy, very warm conditions, widely scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms through tonight. Gusty winds and higher seas expected in showers and thunderstorms. For the central and southeast Bahamas, partly cloudy, hot, breezy, and a bit hazy from Saharan dust. It's going to continue with widely scattered showers and possible thunderstorm through tonight. Small craft caution in effect. Temperatures today getting up to around 90 Fahrenheit, 32 Celsius, but the heat index will make you feel like it's 104 Fahrenheit, 40 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 75 Fahrenheit, 24 Celsius. In your extended and upper level trough will continue to enhance shower activity, mainly over the northwest Bahamas and portions of the central islands into the weekend, while a surface ridge will maintain moderate to fresh breezes over the islands. So for Saturday, tomorrow, partly sunny and very warm, isolated showers and thunderstorms. Sunday, partly sunny, very warm, isolated showers and thunderstorms. We've got a lot happening in the tropics. We've got Brett and we've got now Cindy. We'll tell you about that in our weather check after the 8 o'clock news. This weather check brought to you by the 34th Annual Pineapple Fest. It's back and better than ever, happening June 23rd and 24th. In Gregorytown, Eleuthera. For more information, visit Bahamas.com and don't miss out on the sweetest festival on earth.
Girl, why are you so sweaty?
Darla, getting ready for the Bahamas Games.
Bahamas Games? What that is?
The game started in ninth then Minister of Sports, Peter J. Bethel, and now Minister Mario Boleg.
When the games is?
This July 7th. To the 15th.
For more info,
go to www.thebahamasgames.org
or call 322-1029.
Wherever you're headed, the Custom Computers Know-How Team is standing by to help guide you in the East and the West. We now have two convenient locations on Patton Street in Palmdale and our newest store in the Caves Village Shopping Plaza through the Blake Road entrance. Discover the latest products by top international brands and the knowledge you need to unleash tomorrow's technology today. Drop by Custom Computers out east or out west. We're open Saturdays from 10 till 4.
My business couldn't survive without my credit card machine from Fidelity.
It's fast, convenient, and my clients love it.
My sales increase, and I can track my earnings.
Get your credit card machine from Fidelity.
356-7764.
Total Auto Care on Howard Road offers fast, quality auto maintenance at the very best prices. Tune-ups, oil changes, brakes, suspension, wheel alignments, radiators, water pump replacements, and more. Need quality brand name tires for your vehicle? Tires that'll stand up to these roads? No worries. We supply Michelin, BF Goodrich, Bridgestone, Pirelli, and Toyo. We'll import them fast and install them for you at no extra cost. So when your car needs maintenance or quality tires, we're on Howard Road, just before Burger King. Come see us. Total Auto Care. Call us at 341-6599 or 341-2350.
It's been 35 years since Custom Computers was founded, and we'd like to celebrate that milestone by thanking you, our clients and customers. You've inspired 35 years of expert service and support, partnering with the world's leading brands like HP, Apple, and Microsoft. We take pride in setting the bar for what you expect and deserve from a homegrown Bahamian business. We're here to serve you when you need a 396-1101. Custom Computers, raising the standard since 1987.
When faced with an illness like cancer, we band together. And we at Cleveland Clinic in Florida have your back. From advanced cancer treatments to extra safety measures at all of our locations, we're with you on this journey. For every infusion and follow-up, for every step of the way, for every care in the world, Cleveland Clinic in Florida. Get the care you need when and where you need it. To learn more or connect with a local representative, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
The 50th Independence Secretariat invites you to celebrate 50 and get your praise on at the Sound of Jubilee National Gospel Concert, Sunday, June 25th, 6 p.m. at Bahamas Faith Ministries.
One God, one people.
Dressed to represent in your national colors.
Hey! This event is absolutely free. Give God the glory and celebrate 50. It's the Sound of Jubilee National Gospel Concert this Sunday, June 25th, 6 p.m. at Bahamas Faith.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We're streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at morningblend969 or facebook.com/morningblend969. Text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC 4224796. Standard text rates apply. And now at 8:21, time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance. We've got tropical moisture that's going to continue to stream across the area and enhance occasional bouts of shower activity. Meanwhile, a surface ridge will build across the area and generate moderate to fresh breezes, mainly in the central and southeastern islands. Mariners and beachgoers will be alert for possible water spout activity, and there's also a chance of localized flooding in low-lying and flood-prone areas during heavy and or prolonged rainfall events. And everybody's being advised to limit outdoor activities and stay hydrated as we're expecting another day with the triple digits. All right, so for today, for the Northwest Bahamas, partly cloudy and very warm, widely scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms through tonight. Central and Southeast Bahamas, partly cloudy, hot, breezy, and a bit hazy as there is some Saharan dust in the area. Widely scattered showers and possible thunderstorms through tonight. Temperatures today getting up to around 90 Fahrenheit, 32 Celsius. The heat index will make you feel like it's 104 Fahrenheit, 40 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 75 Fahrenheit, 24 Celsius. Currently 85 degrees under mostly cloudy skies in Nassau. In your extended outlook for your weekend, an upper-level trough will continue to enhance shower activity mainly over the northwest Bahamas and portions of the central islands into the weekend, while surface ridge will maintain moderate to fresh breezes over the islands. So for Saturday, tomorrow, partly sunny, very warm, isolated showers and thunderstorms. Sunday, partly sunny, very warm, isolated showers and thunderstorms again. Got a lot happening in the tropics. Tropical storm Brett. Brett's trailing rain bands continue to produce gusty winds and heavy rains over portions of the Windward Islands. As of 5 o'clock this morning, it was about 115 miles west of St. Vincent. Brett is moving towards the west near 18 miles per hour, and this general motion is expected to continue through the weekend. On the forecast track, the center of Brett will continue moving westward away from the Windward Islands and across the eastern and central Caribbean Sea during the next couple of days. Maximum sustained winds are near 60 miles per hour with some higher gusts. Weakening is forecast, though, during the next couple of days, and Brett could dissipate over the central Caribbean by Saturday night or Sunday. Then we have that depression that we told you about is now Tropical Storm Cindy. Cindy gradually strengthening as of 5 o'clock this morning. Cindy was about 990 miles east of the Lesser Antilles. Cindy's moving toward the west-northwest near 15 miles. Motion is expected to continue over the next few days. On the forecast track, the system could be well east of the northeast of the Leeward Islands through early next week. Maximum sustained winds are near 45 miles per hour. Some strengthening is forecast during the next few days. We're just hoping it stays out in the Atlantic and away from everybody. We'll keep watching that one for you, though, of course. That's your Morning Blend weather check brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance. Visit firstonlineinsurance.com and select a Bahamas First agent to purchase, pay, or renew your car or home insurance 100% online, or just stop by any Bahamas First agent. Bahamas First, celebrating 40 years, is the first Bahamian general insurance company. What's first for you comes first for us. 8:25, time for another check of traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC. In your real-time traffic, not much has changed from our last report. Milo Butler Highway still not looking too bad. Just as you are approaching Harold Pond, you'll see that heavy traffic in front of you on the way to Tawny Gwm's Darling Highway. Tawny Gwm's Darling Highway, though, still busy both directions approaching that roundabout, eastbound and westbound, this morning. Over on Gladstone Road, not looking bad at all. Just near Munnings Road in the northbound lanes, heading to JFK Drive and Bahamar Boulevard in the roundabout there. And just some congestion a little bit westbound on Carmichael to Coral Harbor Road. As we've entered that summertime pattern, so breezy, easy commute for most of you this morning. That's your Morning Glen traffic brought to you by RBC. Visit rbc.com/Caribbean/gear up for an RBC auto loan.
That's the sound of your horn. Get in gear with an auto loan. RBC makes it easy to get your own.
Get in gear with an RBC auto loan with up to 100% financing, extended repayment, and low interest rates. Visit rbc.com/Caribbean/gear up. Conditions apply.
That's the sound of your car or truck. That's the sound of your horn. Get in gear with an auto loan. RBC makes it easy to get your own.
Back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn, along with Laverne Gardner, who's here filling in for Stephen Hanna on this Friday. It is our Municipal Government Week. It's part two this morning as we discuss municipal government, true local government for New Providence and for all of our islands. Today we're going to look at the system that Canada has and try to see if there's any lessons we can learn from Canada on how to manage our country. This morning, we are very blessed. He is a dynamic bilingual public affairs leader with over 20 years of experience in government relations, communications, policy development, and stakeholder relations, serving in a number of capacities over the years. He currently works as the Director of Government Relations at Carleton University and as a Digital Communications Associate at Quinn Public Affairs, a firm that specializes in working with Indigenous communities. We're very pleased to have with us Alistair Mullen. Good morning, sir. Great to have you with us. Unmute your mics for us, please.
Sorry, there we go. Good morning. I'm delighted to be here as well. Perhaps I'd be more delighted to be in the Bahamas. It sounds like you have some really decent weather and some decent beaches, from what I've seen on the internet. Well,
absolutely, so, absolutely. we'd love to have you here. We'd love to have you here.
Yeah, happily the snow is gone in Canada now, but we don't have those beaches, and I'm not sure we're getting quite the same amount of sunshine.
probably not. But it's a pleasure talking with you, Alistair Mullen. All right, so let's begin with something very basic, I guess. Explain the system of governance in Canada for us, the multi-tiered system that you have, exactly how it works.
You bet. I mean, for us, it's actually quite simple. If you look at it, we have officially, constitutionally, only two levels of government. There's the federal government, and then there are provincial governments. So if you're into that kind of thing, you can go on the internet, Constitution Act 1982. And you can scroll down to Section 91 and 92, and 91 tells you what the federal government does, and Section 92 tells you what the province does. And I notice you're talking a lot about municipal government. So in Canada, those municipalities tend to be instruments of the province. So they're Section 92 powers, and they're created. And most Canadians wouldn't know this. In fact, they're actually corporations created under the province. And they function different than, say, a business corporation would, but they're technically the corporations under the province. And so the feds deal with, for the most part, everything sort of looking outwardly. So national defense, foreign affairs, those sorts of things. And then they have some stuff inside the Confederation that is important to run across, say, several jurisdictions. So banking, for instance, trade and commerce. Then you get into stuff like copyright law. And then probably what's distinct to Canada and to North America, they also have responsibility for our relationships with First Nations and Indigenous peoples. Mm-hmm. So the official talk about the relationship with the Crown, and they're talking about the relationship with the federal government. That's not to say they don't have anything to do with the other levels, but that's generally where the relationship starts. And then The province is more local. They get into stuff like regulating marriage. Interesting little bit for the trivia next Saturday night, I would say, down at the beach is in Canada, getting married is a federal jurisdiction. Getting married is a provincial jurisdiction. Getting divorced is a federal one.
Wow.
So they split that one up a little bit. Yeah. So things in the province are things like the regulation of professions and trades. So doctors, plumbers, those sorts of people, those professions are regulated by the provinces. So it may be different in Saskatchewan, a little different in Alberta. But you still got to be able to plug in your light bulb or your recharging cord in Alberta the same way you do in Newfoundland. So those things tend to work well together. Mm-hmm. And then they've got stuff like contract law. But you were referring to municipal governments, and in Canada, those municipal governments fall under the province.
Yeah,
and they're responsible. And it's interesting. So I have run political campaigns at the municipal, provincial, and federal level. People tend to get more excited about my head because. It's really that local government that manages the important things in Canada. So All your waters and sewers are, run by the city. And I would imagine in Bahamas, just like in Canada, clean drinking water and proper sewage are kind of important. I used to work for this municipal guy, and he used to say, in the morning, you get up, you get out of bed, you go downstairs, you make yourself a cup of coffee, you have a shower, you get in the car, and you drive to work. And most people, what they don't realize is that house, how it was built, where it was built, was regulated by the city. The water you drank for your coffee was regulated and managed by the city. The car you got in, the guy who sold it to you at the dealership, that dealership was zoned and created and managed by the city. And then you got on a city road and you drove it to a city job. Mm-hmm. He said, so I never understand why people get so excited about the federal government, which I always thought was an interesting observation.
And they don't mention
sort of how we split things up.
Don't mention the prime minister at all for any of those things, right?
No. Well, this is it. But if you've ever worked in a federal member of parliament's office, which I have, and I'm sure it's the same in the Bahamas, nobody calls the city councilor. Everybody calls the government and says, why can't you fix this? And quite often the answer is, well, that's somebody else's jurisdiction.
Oh, wow. All right. You mentioned a very interesting word when you mentioned the municipalities about corporations. Mm-hmm. Let's talk more about that. And you say it's not like a business corporation, of course, but let's talk more about that and how that works exactly.
You bet. So here in Canada and most provincial jurisdictions, it functions pretty much the same way it does anywhere around the world. The city will have jurisdiction over a specific geographic area designated by the province, and that geographic area will elect a series of councillors and a mayor. Now, in Ontario, where I live, and throughout most of Canada, we have a system where the mayor, once council is elected, is one vote around the council chamber. And mayors will tell you this. They have moral suasion, and they are the mayor because they've run for election across the whole city, and so everybody's. But they're only one vote in a council chamber. Mm-hmm. So, and we've seen it in Toronto, we've seen it in Ottawa here, where at particular times the mayor's council, mm-hmm. and that was it. It's very, very difficult. It's interesting. Municipal government is always a hard one. Because as I said to you, that is a space where, you know, there's not a lot of distance between the voter and the politician and the and, you know, city officials like staff. Like, there's not a lot of distance between your dog and the dog catcher, if you like. Mm-hmm. Those are very immediate things. So people tend to get quite excited and engaged about them when they go wrong. When they're going right, nobody worries. But when they go wrong, people get very upset. And when you're working around a council like that, it's harder to cut a deal, you know, about, well, this won't really matter or this will matter. It does matter. So councillors tend to be very close to their constituents. Mm-hmm. And they tend to have a pretty good sense of what's going on the ground. So when you're zoning a particular piece of the city for commercial or residential, you're deciding where a road's going to go. That's a really, really important thing. And, you know, it's interesting in Canada, Dwight, we have struggled, I would say, over the last two centuries with our relationship with Indigenous peoples. And in a previous life, I spent time working for at that time, the individual they called the Minister of Indian and Northern Affairs. Now we would call that Crown Indigenous Relations. One of the biggest challenges we had in working with Indigenous communities is the Indian Act, which is a federal act which lays down how Indigenous communities are going to be governed, much the same way you govern a municipality. That act never gave those Indigenous band councils a lot of the powers that the municipal governments would take for granted. So zoning was a problem. Mm. And we worked on legislation to amend that to ensure that band councils could zone. So if you ever wanted to know what it looked like when a local government doesn't have the power it needs to do the things that it needs to people, you only need to look at how Canada managed its relationship with Indigenous peoples, wow, you know, up until very recently.
Some would say look at the Bahamas with our form of local government now. But okay, so the council will hold the mayor in check, essentially.
Yeah. They can, yeah. He's just, now, a mayor, again, it's tough to take on the mayor. Mm-hmm. If you're just the councillor for, you know, this little tiny ward, and the mayor says, you know, we got to do this for the sake of the city. The rest of the councillors tend to listen to that. So for local stuff, there's an interesting balance that creates. But you'll find that these mayors and it's interesting because you see, I mean, I often saw people who had been municipal councillors coming up through the federal and provincial legislatures. And these were individuals who knew how to manage a consensus, how to create consensus. They were very, very skilled politicians because they came from a place where they had to be, or they just didn't get elected again. So I've had a profound amount of respect for municipal politicians because it's a hard job, yeah. Really, really hard job. And when you think about, for instance, the staff in a federal minister's office, so I was chief of staff to a federal minister, I had quite a comparatively large staff, almost 20 people. When you work in a counselor's office, you've got two, if you're lucky.
Wow.
You know, and one of those persons is probably managing all the stuff going on in your community. Mm-hmm. So you don't have a lot of time. You got to read all the notes. You got to have a good mind for what comes up from city staff. You got to know how to ask the right questions. It's a tough, tough job. You got to be smart.
Yeah.
There are no silly municipal councillors.
All right. So with all this happening, councillors and mayors, what in running the city, what is the role of the member of parliament, the MP?
So the member of parliament is at the federal level. So they're going to be representing local constituents in the federal. So there's a couple of things they're doing there. There's a straight up regular job of just, you know, my constituents believe the following. I've been to community meetings. I've spoken to people. We don't believe Canada should buy, you know, these type of fighter jets, or we don't believe that, you know, this particular law should be in place. So there's legislative function. And that's the part that everyone sees, you know, is MPs voting and making speeches and so forth. But there's a whole other part of that job that people don't see at all. And the first one is they're meeting with constituents. So when the federal government is doing things like working in places like employment insurance, there's a federal employment insurance situation in Canada where everybody takes a piece of their paycheck, and I'm sure you have something similar to the Bahamas. If you lose your job under certain conditions, you can draw a short-term insurance claim. So there's that. There's immigration. There's all these things going on. And when they don't work, people tend to go to their federal member of parliament and say, hey, I'm not getting the service I need from the government, or this decision has been made and it's wrong and here's why. And federal MPs will try to help constituents navigate that system so they can get their issues resolved. There's a lot of work. So if you look at a federal member of parliament, they probably got one or two mat. And Canada, has signaled that it wants to bring in 500,000 immigrants next year, 500,000 people. That's a lot of immigration applications, and a lot of those people have family in Canada. So federal MPs will be helping people work through their staff will. Mm-hmm. The second thing they'll be doing is back in the legislature itself. So they'll be part of committees. So most MPs are part of one or two of the federal committees. When we're looking at legislation or changes in regulation or things like that, those changes in legislation come first to the House of Commons, and then they're referred to a committee. And those committees, that's where the real work takes place, to be perfectly honest. That's where they'll pull in witnesses and say, hey, should it be this? What about that? That's where stakeholders will become involved and say the government's right or the government's wrong. And MPs have to listen to that, come to a consensus at those committees, and then they got to report back to the House of Commons on what they think changes to whatever legislation. That's a lot of work and sometimes a lot of travel. Mm. I mean, this will be one big distinction, I would suspect, between the Bahamas and between Canada. Canada is the second largest landmass in the world. The distance between Montreal and Vancouver is shorter than the distance between Montreal and Paris. Wow, that's how big this country is. So when you're getting around and traveling, it's a lot. And so, there's regular flights between, say, Montreal, Toronto, and Vancouver and Ottawa. But if you're up in, the prairies or up in the north, say up in Resolute or Nunavut, the flights are a lot less frequent. So it takes time to get across this country. They'll spend some time traveling and seeing people and so forth. Mm-hmm. The other thing they can often do as well is they're part of political parties. So those parties have a caucus, various committees to examine ideas and so forth, and how politically each party wants to respond to changes in legislation, mm-hmm. or what's going on in the country, dreaming up new ideas, new things that they can be doing. So there'll be that part of the job as well. And then many are appointed as either parliamentary secretaries or ministers. So once you're a minister, governments, they're responsible for a large portfolio. They'll have a parliamentary secretary who's also an MP who can help them out in that job, maybe one or two. And then they'll have staff that they've got to manage and so forth. And then you know what? They got to go back to their ridings probably every Friday for the weekends and just talk to constituents, right? Go out to events. That's the business of staying elected.
So, Alistair,
it's a tough job.
One thing I have not heard you say the MP will do is if there's a pothole on your street, or you're having an issue with public transportation or crime in your neighborhood, that's not the MP.
Well, so that's an interesting question. So this is, there you've hit into the Canadian conundrum. It depends whose road it is, Dwight. Is it a federal road? Is it a provincial road? Or is it a municipal road? And I live in Ottawa, and within, I'd say I can hop in my car and I can get on any one of those three roads in about 5 minutes. So if it's a federal road, that the federal government's responsible for filling the potholes, and the province is responsible for filling the potholes on the highways that connect between the cities and inside the city. Yeah. So yes, you will, if you're a local councillor, you're getting a lot of calls about roads, filling potholes, water mains, where the stop sign is, no parking, should there be parking there, shouldn't there be parking? That's a pretty urban thing. If you're living outside of a city, you're getting a lot of phone calls about things like snow clearing, about grading the gravel roads, those are the sorts of things. So yeah, they're getting those calls. What you're trying to do, though, in those governments, if you're a smart politician and a smart legislature, is you're not actually, I always said you will die trying to fill all the potholes in your riding. But you can force the government to come up with a plan and a schedule for keeping those roads, keeping those things in check, like in a state where people aren't calling you about the pothole. And skillful politicians, that's what they're going to do. So if you're a smart local councillor, you're in talking to the transportation committee, talking to the folks at Roadworks and so forth, and asking, okay, what's the schedule? Like, when are you going back through that road? Because one of the things, Dwight, and it's potholes are an interesting thing. You raise potholes in Canada. Every country deals with difficult weather, but Canada deals with extreme changes in temperature. So where I live today, we're probably going to get up to about 30 degrees centigrade. I'm not sure what that is Fahrenheit, but 30 degrees centigrade. Mm-hmm. By the time January rolls around, will be down at negative 30. And with the wind chill, some days to negative 30 40. So that's a 60 degree span. Mm-hmm. And as much as that's tough on me and my cat, that's really tough on a road. Because roads, like this is, you know, some people get too excited about this stuff, is just the materials that we build out of in any country in the world. They expand and they contract based on heat and cold. Mm-hmm. So if you want to see, you know, a difficult road to maintain, take a look at a Canadian. We spend a lot of time on this. And like most jurisdictions, and again, like yours, getting, you know, it's a pain when there's a pothole and you got to get around it to get to your job. Mm-hmm. It's a problem when you got to get your mom to the hospital, you know, or you got to get your kids to school. And so we're very careful about transportation. That's actually a huge part of the federal portfolio. And in any city, strangely enough, in any Canadian city, probably the two largest budgets are going to be the road budget and the snow clearing budget.
Wow.
And you don't have to clear snow in the Bahamas, but no. I'm sure you have other problems. But
definitely. All right. So public transportation would fall under, okay, for the city. Is that a federal issue or is that the local?
Depends on the road. Transportation, mm-hmm. local transportation is all city. So, and we've struggled with that in Ottawa, where we're putting in light rail trains the city has struggled. It's been difficult to manage those large contracts and to pull the right people together to get things done, to plan that size of a project, but that's all a municipality. There's transportation between cities, like across the country, is a federal jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. So, you know, our train network is all regulated by the feds. And that's really because it travels across provincial boundaries, intra-cities. And for Canada, you know, rail transportation really is about moving goods. It's less about moving people. It's a lot less. It's not like in Europe where people get on train and zip around. In Canada, it tends to be goods that we're moving. But inside the city, public transportation, that's going to be a city jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. Now, the other thing we recognize is that quite often, large public transportation projects require upfront capital that cities just cannot access. So quite often, the province and the federal government will look at this and say, okay, you know, we're gonna contribute to those projects because we understand the public good in them and we understand the need for them. So both the federal and provincial governments, for instance, have contributed to the light rail transit system in Ottawa. Now, always around capital. Mm-hmm. They don't want to get involved in paying salaries for train drivers or anything like that. Yeah, right. They'll lay tracks, dig holes, you know, and then they're out. Mm-hmm. They're invested. They're out.
All right,
and so that really is generally a smart thing for the feds is to fund the capital and then let the local jurisdiction figure out how to run it.
Mm. So do you ever hear people say, this is too much government? Why do we do this? Why do we simplify this? Do too many layers?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Always. It's always too much government for people who are disadvantaged by the decision, mm-hmm. And usually not enough government for people who are advantaged by it. Mm. That's an old conundrum. I mean, I can tell you, having worked at all three levels, is governments don't get involved in stuff unless they really have to. They usually have to be dragged into something because it's a lot of work to sustain and maintain these things. You're already doing something else, probably all kinds of other stuff that's important. But yeah, you know, there's always people who you know, feel that there's a little too much regulation, a little too much of this. I mean, I always say that the governments, you know, they're purpose built. But they're a function of the people who work in them and the people they work for. And I've never seen it that it isn't that. So they tend to be creatures of the electorate, and they tend to be creatures of the people the electorate send to whatever legislatures to monitor and manage them. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we all live in democracies. We've got great opportunities for change. But just be careful what you wish for.
Yeah. Before we take a break, Alistair, what would you think of a system where the decisions across the whole country were made by the cabinet and MPs only?
Well, yeah. I mean, so very quickly, it would depend on the size of the country. In Canada, that wouldn't work. I mean, I was born in Alberta. I live in Ontario. Two very, very different places. You know, so it's just, it's for us, it's a function of the size of that government in Canada. And in Canada, we never sort of went down that model. It was when this country was sort of built, as the modern Canada that you know today was built, which is really in the 1860s and again a little bit in the 1930s. It was so huge. In 1867, really, you know, there was a little bit of a telegraph wire, but that was it. So, you know, there was no way the federal government was ever going to be able to tell you where to put a road in downtown Vancouver. It just wouldn't have made any sense. Mm-hmm. It would have taken days to get the message out there. Mm-hmm. We'd still be building the road. So you had to devolve this stuff to mm-hmm. local governments. Mm-hmm. You couldn't do it without that. The other thing was that the local situations were so distinct, never mind the communications, they were so distinct and so different in all of these different places. Canada is a very, when we say a diverse country, it has always been a diverse country. And it changes based on geography and the people who are there a lot. What would a fisherman know in 1867 about growing wheat in Saskatchewan? Nothing. And vice versa. So it wouldn't have made any sense to do something like that. The country never would have held together. And to be perfectly frank, we never would have actually built a road. but that's the choice we made. It comes with some distinct disadvantages that people need to be mindful of, this very, very decentralized process we have. We have a party in our federal parliament who have, you know, a large caucus who are dedicated to removing Quebec from our country. Mm-hmm. The Bloc Québécois have said their goal is to create an independent Quebec. Mm-hmm. You only need to look at a map to say, you know, that'd be a problem for Canada. And they're elected and have been elected to our federal parliament for almost 30 years.
That's a con of such a decentralized system.
I don't know if it is, right? But it's a challenge. But in that decentralized system, not only do we sit around and, you know, we don't have a massive revolution or a civil war or anything like that. We've got people talking about this and accepting that you and I might sit on different sides of the house and have different views, but that today we all have to work together. They're a very constructive group, a political group inside the legislature. Mm-hmm. Easy to work with. Smart, interesting people who just happen to hold this other view. And until then, we all have to work together, and so we do. But it's a difficulty. It's a challenge, right? It's a challenge. Okay. And so those things are hard, you know?
All right, we're going to take a break with Lynn, who is, again, Director of Government Relations at Carleton University. And this is Morning Blend. It's our Municipal Government Week. A whole lot more when we get back. Stay with us.
Total Auto Care on Howard Road offers fast, quality auto maintenance at the very best prices. Tune-ups, oil changes, brakes, suspension, wheel alignments, radiators, water pump replacements, and more. Need quality brand name tires for your vehicle? Tires that'll stand up to these roads? No worries. We supply Michelin, BF Goodrich, Bridgestone, Pirelli, and Toyo. We'll import them fast and install them for you at no extra cost. So when your car needs maintenance or quality tires, we're on Howard Road, just before Burger King. Come see us. Total Auto Care. Call us at 341-6599 or 341-2350.
Indulge in an experience that awakens your senses with Nescafe Gold. Premium Arabica coffee beans, carefully selected, roasted to perfection and finely ground, resulting in a unique and unmatched flavor and aroma that captivates the senses. Intensify your coffee experience with Nescafe Gold.
Ready to save? You can put $100 into the CFAL Savings Express plan and make sure your money keeps growing. Earn interest on your savings while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
Tired of paying too many bills and loan payments each month?
Shrink your monthly debt payments down to one easy payment with our debt consolidation loan.
It also has a built-in savings that pays you 5% interest.
Inquire about our debt consolidation loans today.
call 356-7764.
You could win your share of $1,000 and free annual memberships when you apply for your Mobile Assist Visa Travel Rewards Card. It's a prepaid Visa that gives you access to travel and online shopping deals worldwide every single day. Enter automatically when you successfully apply through our Mobile Assist app. Use your prepaid Visa five times or more, and you are automatically entered to win your share of $1,000. See our social media pages for more details. Apply, save, and win with Mobile Assist.
Bahamas Games? What was the purpose of the games?
The purpose is twofold. One, to bring Bahamians from throughout the Commonwealth. And the second, to find talented athletes throughout the Commonwealth of the Bahamas to be trained and possibly make it to the Olympic level.
When the games is?
This July 7th to the 15th.
For more info, call 322-1029.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9, Dwight Strong along with Laverne Gardner. We are talking with Alistair Mullen, who is a director of government relations at Carleton University and a digital communications associate with Quinn Public Affairs, a firm that specializes in working with Indigenous communities. He is guiding us through the tiers of government for Canada and how that works, and having a great conversation with him so far this morning. All right, so I have a couple scenarios here, Alistair, I want to ask you about to see who would be responsible for making the decision. Would it be the federal government or the provincial government? An investor for a brand new factory, and they want to put it in Ottawa. Who would make, maybe Ottawa's not a good example because it's since the federal government is there.
But it's a great example. Yeah? It's a great example, Dwight. I live here. We're okay. Trying to get all the factories we can. Yeah.
All right. So who?
Not a factory, Dwight.
Not yet. But who decides that Ottawa would be the best place for it to go? Who do you talk to? Do you have to talk to the Prime Minister at all? Or is it the mayor? Is it the governor of Ontario?
So, you know what? You've hit on an excellent example. It's actually really quite relevant right now. So right now, everybody in the world is trying to attract electrical car technology, right? Like every planet, or there's probably in the Bahamas, you got something. How do we fit into this global supply chain around the electrical car boom? And in Canada, the way we thought we're going to do it is through car manufacturing, particularly batteries. So the government and so a lot of these are multinational companies who built these things. So the first people they're going to talk to is the federal government. Hey, Volkswagen, we're Stellantis in one case. Mm-hmm. We want to build a factory. So the first, because they're based in Germany or based in the United States, and it's the first thing they're going to call is the federal government. Federal government's going to say, we'd love to have your factory here, and they're going to pull in the province. Because some manufacturing is regulated by the province, but commerce inside a particular province is regulated by that province. So building something, like creating something you're buying and selling, for the most part, this can be regulated there. And they may also, they're probably going to need some skilled trade, skilled workers, things like that. Again, those things are regulated by the province. So you're going to want to bring them to the table. And then you need to put it somewhere. And usually those things, are put inside an industrial zone in a municipality. So the municipality will come to the table and they'll talk about, if we're going to build a factory. So What are the development charges? How are you going to do all that stuff? And of course, you're trying to pull these people into Canada. So all three levels of government are going to have a conversation with each other about, okay, how can we make it more interesting for these people? You know, like, what can we do? Can you waive development charges for, putting in the water and sewer, city of Ottawa, because we want to make it more attractive? You know what? Yeah, we'll do that because we're going to get some jobs. The province will come in and they may say, okay, you know, we're going to need skilled workers in these five areas. I don't know what they are. We need to train some. So, you know, we're going to put some money out there for training so that these guys have, possibility of training people who are needed at that factory. And the federal government's going to come in and say, you know, it's in the national interest for us to have a battery manufacturing plant in Canada because we're going to use it for all this other stuff and it's going to create all this. We're just going to put some money on the table and tax credits for programs, research and development tax credits, all that sort of thing. And they'll pull it all together. And hopefully when it works, and that's a big if or a big when, right? When everybody, you know, can work together and say, okay, this makes sense. That's how you'll see those decisions made. But the decisions are particular to various levels of government. So, you know, the zoning is always going to be the municipality. You know, a lot of health and safety and so forth, things like that, always a decision, a jurisdiction of in provincially regulated areas of the province. If it's a transportation issue, for instance, always going to be the feds. Mm-hmm. And everybody's got to work together.
Yeah.
And That's the Gordian knot of Canada. So what's one of the more interesting things you'll find in Canada is that, for example, right now in Ontario, we have a conservative government run by a guy named Doug Ford. And our federal government is, of course, Justin Trudeau, who's a liberal. These parties have spent the last, 150 years duking it out every election. Once those elections are over, and everybody's got to work together, they get to it,
Right. So in that example, can another province come in and make a competing offer?
Yeah.
Yeah. You've seen that happen
before. Can Ontario are always competing for different things, as are the Atlantic and Western provinces. Mm-hmm. And they'll have to get together. But quite often as well, you'll have already industries planted in those regions. So auto manufacturing has been in Canada since Ontario since the 1920s. There's a long history in southern Ontario of being part of an integrated Canadian-U.S. Auto manufacturing system. If you want to build an airplane, though, you're probably better off in Montreal, Quebec, where they have a long-standing commitment since the Second World War to building airplanes. Mm-hmm. Western Canada is all about energy and oil and mineral extraction technologies. So those are certainly naturally people sort of land in those places. Mm-hmm. If you want to do semiconductors, you're probably going to Toronto. Things like that. There's some semiconductor work here in Ottawa. There's natural clusters of industry
right. Where
things are happening.
But the prime minister and the cabinet wouldn't make the decision as to where you would go.
Probably not. Mm-hmm. They would probably respond to an industry request. We don't really plan the economy in that way. Just because business in the end, the businesses are going to decide where they're going to go. And to be perfectly frank, they're going to go where it's most advantageous for them to go. And so, looking at labor pools and so forth becomes important. Availability of land. So those are things that become, sort of relevant. If when I was a consultant, you'd work on the other side of these sorts of deals. The businesses are looking at things through a very different lens. They're looking at saying, okay, where can I find enough people who are qualified to work at whatever it is that I'm doing? How close is it to my customers? Where is it in my supply chain? What's the transportation network that already exists there? What's that like if I'm manufacturing good or anything? Do they have internet? Which is a big question in Canada sometimes. Mm-hmm. So those sorts of things start to become important. And then they say, okay, here are four or five locations on the planet where I can do X, Y, or Z. Now let's start talking to governments. And the answer from any government, when a business shows up and says, hey, I'd like to locate, center there, the answer is yes. How do we make that work? And then it's just a question of getting together and developing a kind of a bidding system so that it does work.
Yeah.
And I expect that's the same in your country as it is in mine.
Sort of. But, okay.
You know, like if we want to talk Turkey here, you know, for us in Canada, there's always politics. But I think what we found in Canada, and I think which people find fairly quickly is, you know, good investments are good politics for everybody. Like they help everybody.
Right.
So there's a grudging, there's ability to put aside politics. Now, does the federal government, this is the other thing, which will be slightly different from the Bahamas, is that Canada also recognizes that we have these pockets of wealth. So southwestern Ontario up to Ottawa, like that part of Ontario, extremely wealthy. Mm-hmm. And lots of people there. Not so many people as you start to get into northern Ontario. So Canada will develop, does things which we call industrial regional benefit, where we'll say, okay, you know what, we want to develop industry in this part of Ontario, this part of Quebec or whatever. And you know, there may be some funny business from time to time, but generally you just need people to get jobs into those regions.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's probably where I think you're going with this. The trick is to stream that political will into something that makes sense in terms of developing the economy.
Absolutely.
Because that's where it works really well.
Yeah. You know? So the governor then is going to play a major role in attracting people to the province. Let's talk more about what the governor does.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But Premier. States.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the Premier, you know, I mean, the Premier again, I mean, these tend to be, and at the provincial level, they're looking at stuff, you know, that's really quite often most relevant to the labor force. So the province is responsible. Two big things the provinces are responsible for are healthcare and education. So one of the things, for instance, that gives Canadian workers an advantage over U.S. workers is the Ontario Health Insurance Plan in Ontario. And there's one in Quebec, and there's one in Newfoundland, and there's one across there. The system is having some difficulties at the moment. We have a universal health insurance program. So nobody in Canada who's a citizen or a resident here is uninsured. Mm-hmm. And they're insured by the province. So when you're trying to get a worker at a factory in Alabama, they got to come up with healthcare insurance themselves. And that's a major cost in the United States. Who are our major, you know, major collaborator and major competitor. And in Canada, that's not an issue. Like I have health insurance through my employer to cover prescription drugs and, you know, physio, things like that. But really, really basic, the real healthcare you need, it's dealt with through the province. So that keeps the price down on labor. The other thing the province regulates and runs is the education system from university down to kindergarten. And so they make sure it's standard, they make sure it's there. And now, and you're seeing this already in Ontario, where industry is saying we need more skilled trade workers. You see the province really pushing and funding education for skilled trades. And so if you come into, if you're a large business and you want to make an investment in a plant or a center in Ontario, and you say, look, I need more engineers and more accountants and I need more plumbers, the province can help respond. Okay, you know, let's find a location close to, you know, a university and a college. Let's help you with that. Let's look at, okay, you know, and they're tracking that labor market data for multiple different businesses, and I'll turn around to the sector and say, look, we need more of this and more of that. And you'll see it. We're still in the K-12 system, and they're both coming home most weeks talking about skilled trades, which is really interesting. Wow. When I was a high school student, they didn't, you know, I was talking about soccer.
Right.
I was gonna be a soccer player and an archaeologist. My son wants to be a welder.
Wow.
So, you know, I mean, you see those things starting to come.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. Amazing. Yeah. All right, so we're getting questions about this. People asking, okay, funding. How does this work? Who's funding the municipalities, the provinces? Does the federal government contribute to this?
Well, Dwight, I am. So as we say in Canada, there's only one taxpayer, but three levels or two levels of government. So I pay federal taxes and I pay provincial taxes off my income. There's also in most provinces what we call the harmonized sales tax, goods and services tax. It was collected by the feds and redistributed to the province. Both the province and the feds set a rate. So here in Ontario, the federal rate is 6%, the provincial rate is 7%. So whenever I go in and I buy a restaurant meal or I buy a chocolate bar, I pay an extra 13% on top in that sales tax. And those fund the provincial and federal governments. And then they also charge excise taxes and things like that. But that's a lot less of the revenue than it used to be. Corporate income tax as well. So that pays for the feds in the province. The feds tend to collect those taxes on behalf of the province and then send them back. You know, each province knows, you know, they know Alistair lives in Ontario and they know how much money I made. So, you know, they divide that up and off it goes. Then on top of that, I pay property taxes and I pay a water fee and a, you know, a piece there. So those are paid. And so that's how those things are funded. But we recognize in Ontario and Canada that in some years, some provinces are going to do better than others. And we don't want one province winding up particularly impoverished. There was a time, for instance, when Newfoundland was going through a lot of difficulties because their main industry was the fisheries and there just weren't fish to be caught. So what kicks in at that point is the Federation has a formula by which the federal government will redistribute funds into, you know, we loosely call them have-not provinces. Now, and that's supposed to be a short-term thing. So, you know, for instance, it took a while, a few years in Newfoundland. Now Newfoundland had some major expansion in their oil and gas industry, and now they're a have-province. They're contributing more into the Federation than they take out. So we try to redistribute so that the provinces, you know, there's some continuity of service and you don't wind up with these problems. The second then is the provinces then will transfer some money down to the municipalities as well. So there's a transfer from the province down to the city to between what the city is getting in terms of effectively property taxes and what the province is able to collect. And so that's how we distribute the income, if you like, at the various levels of government. But as Prime Minister Brian Mulroney always said, there is only one taxpayer and it comes out of their pocket.
Wow. I'm sure I know the answer to this. Do people feel they know where their tax money's going? Do they feel like they can see their tax money at work?
Well, yeah. I mean, look, there's a lot of, I mean, what's interesting is one of the mantras of Canadian politics over the last few years has been tax cuts and, you know, holding the line on taxes. And as somebody sort of been a general observer of these things for the last few years, I think we're seeing the point where we're going to have to think about how much we pay in taxes because we may not be paying enough to get the services we want. I mean, this is the thing is government is not free. And if you want the gold-plated service when you go to get your passport done or, you know, when you go to the hospital, you're going to pay gold-plated prices. And people have to accept that. You can't expect government when everyone else is you know, seeing inflation go up and, you know, you see the dividends going out to shareholders and some of these corporate salaries. You can't expect the government level of service.
Right.
You can tighten that belt so long as you're willing to accept that you're not going to have the same level of service.
Yeah. Alistair, that's just that. Here's a text here. This person says, I'm going to read this text and then I'm going to hear your answer and then I'm going to read it again when I paint a scenario for you. So here's a text. Dwight, so local government will lead to more taxes collected by the same government you have a problem with. That sounds like a solution to you. What do you say to people who think like that? This is going to mean more government and more taxes and more stress on the electorate.
You know what I think, Dwight? I think you got to vote. Look, government costs money. And there's just no two ways around that. If you don't like the way it's spending your money, then you got to get out and vote. And you may get upset because for 3 or 4 years, you got to deal with whatever it is. I didn't support this in my tax dollar. I always say to people, like, think of the alternative, which is complete chaos. It's violent. It's violent revolution. It's nuts. The system is a little slow to react. Some days, because that's for consistent and stable government. And I will take that any day over that. And we just have to accept some days that our neighbors you know, boy, it's like when you live next door to someone and you share maybe a lawn or a driveway, right? And maybe less of an issue for you, Dwight, mm-hmm. but who shovels the snow in the winter? Mm-hmm. You know, right. Like who's going to shovel the snow? And so some winters, man, you shovel a lot of snow and your neighbor probably drinks a lot of coffee. And you know, it is what it is. But in the summer, you have a conversation with the neighbor, say, hey, I need you to shovel the walk a little more often. And next year they do. You know, it is what it is, mm. man. It's better than that and getting into a fisticuff over who's going to shovel the driveway.
Wow.
Like I say, less an issue in Bahamas, but I right. have the metaphor
words. All right, so I'm gonna read this again, but I'm going to paint a scenario yeah. for you. You're in a city with more than 200,000 people, and there is no mm-hmm. local municipal government of any kind. You don't have a unified mm-hmm. public transportation system. Potholes have taken over, and crime is a major problem, and all the things that are wrong in major cities, you've got in abundance. So I read the message again with that scenario. So local yeah. government will lead to more taxes collected by the same government you have a problem with. Does that sound like a solution to you?
Okay, so here's, so you know, I'm going to give you another scenario that I hope will help. Because I don't think it's not about that. The question you're asking is not about tax. It's about government. It's mm-hmm. about how do you organize? And it's about that conversation with the neighbor who doesn't want to shovel the snow. Mm-hmm. You got to have that conversation with the neighbor who doesn't want to shovel the snow. You can't forget them. You can't ignore that person. You got to come to a consensus. Government, local government in particular, is about people working together. You know, like a number of years ago, the city of Edmonton was trying to reduce costs. This is where I was born, in Alberta. And so one of the things they said was, I go back to snow, because snow's big in Canada. And there's a lot more snow in Alberta than there is in Ontario. Anyway, the municipal was trying to save money, okay? And so it's easy to run a big snow plow down the street. I mean, that's easy to do. And not particularly expensive. More expensive is clearing the sidewalk. And the people who use the sidewalk are the people generally who don't have enough money to get a car. So, you know, the elderly, let's say, or the very young. Or maybe they're disabled and they got a wheelchair and they can't afford it. They really need that sidewalk. And it's expensive. And at one point, the city of Edmonton said, people have to shovel their own sidewalks, trying to save some money. And so immediately, wow. I had these people come and say, well, look, I'm an 80-year-old grandmother. How am I going to shovel? So you know what happened? There was another discussion a couple of years later, and they started clearing the sidewalks again. But before that happened, people went next door and they cleared their neighbor's sidewalk. They cleared, you know, if your neighbor was 83 years old, too bad for you, man. You had to shovel a little more because it was your neighbor. Mm. You know, like people have to work together. So take the time to find a place where, if you do live in that place where there's no municipal government, you got to create one. You got to get people there at the table for the conversation. And the wonderful thing is you're going to get to choose what that municipal government, what you all want that municipal government. Maybe you don't want it to shovel this. Maybe you do. I don't know. Like, those are the things, but it's that, and it's hard. It's hard work, right? Like, I'm not telling you, it's as easy as wave a wand and it gets done. Mm. And it's hard because it matters. You know, like, it's hard because it matters.
Right.
This is the stuff that really matters. So you got to find those people in your community. You know, the other people with the time and consideration to shovel their neighbor's sidewalk. You don't want the guy who didn't shovel his sidewalk. He's probably not going to show up. So you want those people who have an extra shovel. You want to find those people because they're the ones who are going to be the creative ones, and they're going to figure out what collectively you want to pay for. And they'll go to central government and say, "We don't want you to do this anymore. We're going to take care of this party, mm-hmm. and you're going to take part of there." That's how you do it. You know, and people do this, by the way, all the time. They do it at community association meetings. They do it in their local Boy Scouts chapter. Like, they do all that stuff. Those people are out there. They're in droves. And I bet you got thousands of them mm-hmm. on those islands. Mm-hmm. Thousands of them. And, I mean, you've got a community as well. It's interesting. Like, I was listening to your weather report. Like, you got like two tropical storms coming in, man. Like, and I'll bet you're going to clean up after that and move on, and things will be okay. Because those people who do that stuff, you know who they are, and you know they're going to be the people who do what they do. Those are the people you need around the table.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have tropical storms in Ottawa. You know, we just have a lot of snow.
Mm-hmm. Alistair Mulling, you've given us a lot to think about. We definitely need to talk with you again. Thank you so much for the time this morning. Really appreciate this and giving us a glimpse into how Canada functions. But we do appreciate it so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Lots of fun, right? Lots of fun. These things are these great conversations to have. And you know, Canada's also always evolving. So, you know, we'll be learning from Bahamas as well as you right. might learn from us.
Well, look at that.
Yeah.
Well, we appreciate it.
Yeah.
Alistair, thank you again.
We'll talk soon.
Yes, you absolutely. Know. You too. You too. And come and visit us at some point.
Take care.
All right. Take care.
That sounds like a great idea.
Yes.
Probably in January, though.
Sounds good. Sounds
Take
good.
Care, Dwight.
All right. You too.
Bye.
All right. So that was part two of Municipal Government Week. Coming up on Monday, you definitely don't want to miss it. A Bahamian who is doing great things in a local government system in Florida. You definitely want to hear about that. We're going to get into that on Monday as we continue. We're going to take a break for news and then be back with Morning Blend Business. This is Morning Blend on a Friday morning here on Guardian Radio. Stay with us.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas. Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Friday, June 23rd, 2023. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn. Laverne had to leave us, unfortunately, but so it's just me. And I'm in studio, though, with Amanda Friedman, the communications manager at the Nassau Cruise Port. Amanda, great to see you again.
Good to see you, too. Good morning.
Haven't seen
me.
You since the opening day at the port.
That's it, yeah.
Yeah.
I promised you we'd be back.
That's right. And you're back with some good news.
We are, yeah.
Got
we're
another
super
big
excited.
Day.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's talk about that. What's happening?
Awesome. So tomorrow, Saturday, June 24th, the Nassau Cruise Port is holding its public opening.
Mm-hmm.
So essentially, we're running daytime entertainment from 12 to 6 p.m. And then we are running a beautiful jazz concert from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So full day. And then so does this mean that from here on, members of the public will be able to access the port?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes. We will be open and we're happy to receive our Bahamian community. Right. We're also going to be open to stopover guests from Atlantis and Bahamar,
mm-hmm.
Airbnbs, any of the other hotels. So, you know, we're open for business.
So this
really
is it.
This is it. You're really, really open.
This
now. Is it. We're really,
okay.
really open now.
Wonderful. All right. So for those who aren't familiar, I mean, I don't know where they've been, but tell people what Nassau Cruise Port is all about.
Yeah. So Nassau Cruise Port is just finished and ready to unveil its $300 million redevelopment and expansion of the cruise port on Prince George Wharf. Over the last 3 years, he has been busy with demolishing, constructing, and now ready to showcase its authentic Bahamian space, its beautiful new tenant areas, retail, food and bev. You know, we've got a lot of exciting things coming in the next few weeks and months as well, but we're really going to take the opportunity tomorrow to welcome people to our space and to provide some entertainment and to also showcase the amphitheater, which we're so excited about. It was a big buzzworthy item at our grand opening held the end of May. And this is going to be a unique take on a concert there because it's a jazz concert. Wow. So we're so excited for that part of it.
All right. So we're going to get the details about tomorrow in just a bit. I want to ask, I know that there were still some places that weren't open yet or weren't ready at the official opening. How are they looking? Are they open now?
So some of them have come on stream since then. We do have a few that are just shy of being ready. So it'll be a few more weeks. Okay. But the good thing with that, or I guess the positive thing with that, is that in the next few weeks and months, there'll be more new things to see.
So there'll be something different every time.
Yeah. And it'll be something to celebrate each time.
Yeah.
But, you know, we're excited for everybody who's open now. And they're so excited to welcome the public. And they've been able to see it, really. And the big thing about that is that in the history of Prince George Wharf being a cruise port, it's always been behind the secure area. So the fence was always exactly at the road where it was literally just for cruise passengers.
Right.
The Nassau Cruise Port Project has moved that fence. And so the area, the 11 acres that we have retail and food and beverage in now, and all of these exciting attractions and entertainment, is now open. And it's our ISPS pre-clearance area. So you are able to be in there. Our security teams, health and safety, Royal Bahamas Defense Force, Royal Bahamas Police Force, you know, they'll be helping us manage that space. But we're so excited because it's going to be a family-friendly area for people to come and enjoy.
Yeah, a new option for entertainment.
That's it, exactly.
For everybody.
Yeah,
wonderful
and we're
stuff.
We're building a calendar of entertainment too, you know, over the next few months and things like that. You'll be seeing some more things come on stream where we have entertainment planned. It'll be concerts, you know, it could be events in the day, could be pop-ups. You know, lots of exciting possibilities there.
Anything happening around Independence?
I love this. Thank you for giving me that solid. Yeah, we do.
Okay.
So I will tell you, I don't have anything official to share yet. We will do some media and some publicity around that to tell our community what to expect for Independence.
Okay.
But of course, Nassau Cruise Port, our proudly Bahamian team, is ready and excited to celebrate our 50 years of independence.
Excellent.
So we'll be sharing what we're going to do on that day, too.
That's beautiful. All right. So give us some of those names. Name drop some of the businesses that are in the in the area now, in the cruise port area.
Well, let me actually start with something that's really important that I don't want to forget to mention. Tomorrow during our events, the Gallery and Wine Bar, which is curated by Antonius Roberts, they're having a art exhibition. John Cox and Antonius Roberts will be unveiling a exhibition that they're calling Love of Country.
Wow.
So this is so timely on the, you know, the heels basically of our 50th independence. The director, the creative director, Alexandria Robinson, has been putting together this show with Antonius and his team. And tomorrow, the members of the public will be able to see that as well. So they're having an event. They're kind of using this as their grand opening as well. And that's happening from 12 to 6 tomorrow too.
At the art gallery.
At the art gallery, exactly. But what you'll see tomorrow when you come into the space is all of our Port Marketplace tenants. So our former Festival Place legacy tenants, supplemented by the new additions from Ministry of Tourism. A lot of them will be there and open tomorrow. Then we also have Bahama Handprints, My Ocean. We have Greycliff Chocolatier. They will be showcasing their Chocolatini, I believe, tomorrow. We'll also have a fashion show in the space. So we'll, you know, showing. Yeah.
Okay.
We'll be showing what our beautiful Port Plaza vendors and marketplace vendors have in the way of fashion.
Okay.
There'll be shopping. We have a kitty corner planned. We have lawn games. And then in the evening, when we have our jazz concert, which will feature Jazz Cats and Givton Jelen, recently graduated from Juilliard, he has.
Oh.
So we'll have lots of entertainment there in that space on the amphitheater. We're encouraging members of the public in our community to bring a chair or a blanket and relax. Come, take a breath, take in the sweet breeze that exists at the amphitheater and really immerse yourselves in a beautiful jazz concert.
So where do you park if you're driving to downtown?
That's a wonderful question. It's very, very commonly asked. Park where you can find parking. We know that, you know, the Point has parking, Financial Center has parking. In the evening event, for those that are coming to our jazz concert, you know, Bay Street will have closed by that time, or at least some of the stores will have closed, so there should be some parking on Bay. So just wherever you can find parking, we encourage you to come on down.
Yeah. And some of the other stores that may not be open now, but will be opening over the next few weeks. Give us some of those names.
Yeah, so Vita Kaya opening. They're going to be coming on stream. That's a resort wear line designed by a local Bahamian. Bahari also is just shy. And then we have some food outlets. So you would have heard, or I hope you would have heard, Preacher's Kid, Chef Simeon Hall Jr.'s restaurant with the University of the Bahamas. That will be coming on stream in the next few weeks.
That's very exciting.
Isn't it? Yeah. No, I'm so excited. Yeah, we can't wait. Amazing. And then we also have Bamboo Shack coming on stream, and Island Post as well, another food and beverage outlet.
Yeah.
But you can expect Isola Gelato will be open, and the gelato is incredible. We see passengers walking by. They are open now. Okay. And we see passengers walking by with their little cups, their brightly colored cups. And they just like, I mean, they jam in their ice cream. Right. They love it. It's so great.
And they've got unique flavors, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
The Bahamian flavors.
Yes, they do. Yeah. They have really a plethora, but they're... their Bahamian flavors are to die for. Yeah. Really, really nice. Wow. Yeah.
All right. So let's talk a little more again about tomorrow, starting from 12 o'clock. Yep. Do you need anything special when you get there? ID? How does it work exactly?
It's always a good idea to bring ID. We will have security in place, of course, to make sure that we maintain our family-friendly atmosphere. But come on down. Bring some money with you to spend with our tenants.
That's
you
important.
Know, there's lots of good shopping, good food and beverage. There's lots of good experiences to be had. And come ready to have fun. You know, we want people at the end of this to walk away knowing that Nassau Cruise Board is the place to be in 2023 and beyond, and to plan to keep coming out to our events because we're excited to showcase our space.
You've got, did you mention this before? The marching bands?
I didn't. No, thank you. Yeah. So, Police Force Marching Band, we love having them there and always such a huge draw, not only for cruise passengers, but also when members of the public can see them, because we've done some parades on Woods Rogers Walk as well with them. They'll be there. The Bahamas All-Star Marching Band will be there.
Okay.
Yeah, we've got lots of entertainment going on. We have DJ Excitement is going to be there. So we have, you know, music throughout. We know that people haven't seen the space yet, too, so we're hoping they'll come just to take a peek.
All right, so it is a big space, but I mean, how many people can you accommodate? Is there a point where it's like, oh, this is too many right now?
There could potentially be, to be honest, Dwight. Tomorrow, however, we have two ships in.
Okay.
Our security team, health and safety team, would be monitoring the situation.
So two ships is not the most. You have a lot more, often six sometimes.
That's it. Right. We often have six, actually. And as we gear up into our busy season, which will be the end of the year, so the fall on, we'll see lots of six ship days.
Right.
We're kind of in our slow period. We don't really have a slow period because we're the busiest transit port in the world. But this is a slow period for
you,
you know, I guess relative, right?
Right.
Slower period. But we have two ships in tomorrow. Okay. And we don't anticipate any issues with that, though we'll be monitoring the situation.
Yeah.
And if there's anything to do with capacity, our team will communicate that.
Okay.
But we're open, we're excited, we're ready to see, you know, who comes out to see us. We've had a lot of people promising that they'd come out to see us once they had the chance.
Right.
So, you know, we're looking forward to
connect. A lot of people have been anxiously waiting to get in there.
I know.
All right. Food trucks. Tell us about those.
We've partnered with some local food trucks. They're going to be out on site. And this is just to supplement, you know, the offerings on the day and to make sure that people, you know, can come out, grab a bite to eat. You know, their kids can do something fun. They can listen to the music. They can walk around and shop and things like that. So we kind of wanted to make it a destination where people could have everything they possibly wanted for a Saturday outing with their family.
And
food trucks will be out. We'll also have Sands and Bahamian Brewery providing liquor for those that want to have a cocktail, you know, after 12. Then, you know, grab a Sands Light or something. And we're really looking forward to it, to seeing how everybody, you know, comes to the space and when it is.
And then, as you said, you get right into 6 p.m. and jazz on the green.
Yeah. So our schedule runs from 12 to 6 during the day. It's all, you know, thought out where we'll have, you know, all these activations and things and, you know, the police force band, junk canoe rush outs, things like that throughout the day. And then jazz on the green begins at 6 p.m.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the Jazz Cats, that's...
Adrian Diagler.
Right.
Yeah. You know, everybody knows that he's just, I mean... And he's so well known in the jazz community.
Yeah, that's going to be amazing.
We're so excited to have them take to the stage and, you know, provide us some beautiful music.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking to see. The weather's going to cooperate, right?
Yeah, so we're keeping an eye on the weather, too. Mm-hmm. Our last reports said that we were looking pretty good.
Yeah, it shouldn't be too bad.
Hopefully, you know, the weather gets out the way today.
Definitely not like how it was a few days ago.
Yeah, all right, exactly.
So everything's coming together.
It is.
Look at that.
Yeah, it's coming together. We're really excited. Mm-hmm. We think that, you know, what we've heard, I guess the feedback that we've heard is that people think that it's really nice. They think it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. We love hearing that because it gives us such pride as Bahamians to be able to have, you know, this jewel, this gem, you know, in our backyard.
Yeah.
Something that, you know, the Bahamian people have, you know, worked hard on over the last, you know, 3 years. We have theirs.
Finally, right?
Yeah. And that's really like exactly how you said it. Finally, mm-hmm. That's how people feel. That's how our team feels too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, finally we get to this point with all this, this hard work and all of this collaboration, this coming together, stakeholder involvement, all of this engagement. And we know that there will be nothing but positivity and progress from here on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. So how do you get in? If you're a member of the public, you want to get in, where do you enter from?
So entrance will be closest to the straw market, the mm-hmm. back of the straw market. That's Frederick Street, I believe that lines up with.
Mm-hmm.
There's the entrance there. What that'll do is I'll put you right at our West Marina and Amphitheater Green. So mm-hmm. you'll be able to walk the space from west to east and take it all in.
That's best. Don't enter from the east side.
No. Enter from the west for sure. Okay. That's the best mm-hmm. way to do it because you'll be in the heart of the action immediately.
Okay.
And that's the gate that we'll be you know, receiving our guests in.
Yeah.
So they'll be able to walk the space, they'll walk through, they'll see all the various activations, they'll be able to make their way to the Port Marketplace. They'll see the soon-to-be open Junkanoo Museum, though I believe they intend on having something at their space potentially tomorrow.
Okay.
But, you know, it's going to be beautiful. They'll be able to walk around the Arrivals Plaza and take it all in. They'll see our iconic Arrivals Terminal building that we've been talking about for mm-hmm. so long. Beautiful view from the harbor, but it's a stunning view from the Arrivals Plaza too.
Wow. And in the last few weeks, what are you hearing from the cruise ship passengers? What
They're
are they
loving
saying?
Loving it. Yeah. So we've had really good feedback, I will be honest.
Mm-hmm.
And we're keeping our ear to the ground on more of that feedback, mm-hmm. right? We want to make sure that passengers are loving what we're doing as we continue to, you know, stress test our systems and our procedures, our logistical aspect of organization. But we've heard that they really like it.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people had been telling us, you know, we can't wait to see you when you're open. We, mm-hmm. you know, this is my 17th trip to Nassau, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
We've watched through the, you know, through the little green screen, mm-hmm. watching the construction, that type of thing. And when they actually see it, we're getting really good feedback, especially on our social media, where they're like, you know, messaging us on the side or messaging us on Instagram and saying, I think they call that DMs, right?
Yeah.
They're in our DMs telling us they love it.
Right.
Or they're posting on our Facebook being like, this is incredible. We can't wait to come back.
Yeah.
So that's really encouraging because, mm-hmm. you know, we want there to be lots to see and do for the cruise passengers as well because we are the busiest transit port in the world. It is likely that people taking a cruise through the Caribbean would touch Nassau at some point or the
mm-hmm.
other. And we think that our space has a lot to offer. Especially now in this reimagined state.
Right.
So we're excited about that.
Yeah. Can you imagine when all of downtown Nassau looks like this?
I can't wait.
Oh,
I see lots of construction in downtown Nassau, I will tell you.
Uh-huh.
And just personally, that, you know, I'm so encouraged by that progress. I see, you know, people are fixing.
Construction or demolition? Because
both. No, but I've seen construction mm-hmm. and I really have. Like, I used to do a lot better before our grand opening.
Yeah.
I used to do a lot better about doing like a monthly walk
mm-hmm.
or every 3 weeks a walk. And I would walk from our offices on Bay Street close to East Street.
Yeah.
And I would walk all the way down to the point and come back
mm-hmm.
and just see what it looked like, see what, you know, the vibe was, see how busy it was and what construction was. I've seen some turnover in some spaces, you know, some new tenants down on Bay. But, you know, Bay Street is historical and absolutely gorgeous. I know a lot of people have a lot of feelings about Bay Street and what it could be.
Right.
But it really, the potential is so there.
Oh, absolutely.
In terms of other places in the world, other cities,
mm-hmm.
Bay Street is phenomenal. And our city, mm-hmm. the city of Nassau, is 300 years old.
My goodness.
You know?
Soon.
Yeah,
soon
absolutely.
We're going to get it together.
So excited.
We're going to get
it
together. All right, so one more time, Amanda, tell us about tomorrow, what's going to be happening, and going forward, what people will be able to do at the Nassau Cruise Port.
Awesome. So tomorrow, Saturday, June 24th, from 12 p.m. to 10 p.m., we have events at Nassau Cruise Port. taking it in two parts. We have from 12 p.m. to 6 p.m. daytime entertainment. We'll have a fashion show. We'll have the police force marching band, the Bahamas All-Star marching band. We'll have music throughout the space, food trucks selling goods, Bahamian Brewery there to provide us with libations. And then in the evening, we'll kind of get into a jazz concert that's from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. And that'll be featuring Jazz Cats and Givton Jelen in the jazz area of the amphitheater. And also a special note, the Gallery and Wine Bar, which is our art gallery at the port, they're holding an exhibition called Love of Country. Mm-hmm. And it's an exhibition by Antonius Roberts and John Cox. And that's going to be taking place from 12 to 6 as well. Mm. So there's going to be
will
lots of fun things.
The wine bar part be open?
Yes, it okay. will. Okay. It will. They have told me the wine bar part will be open.
Oh gosh.
Right?
Okay.
So we're encouraging Bahamians, mm-hmm. our families, our community. Come on down. Bring your money. Bring your friends. Bring your family. Bring your, you know, beautiful, positive mindset and get ready mm-hmm. to experience Nassau Reimagined.
Before you go, here's a question somebody's asking.
Ooh.
Did I miss the investor opening? Is that still happening?
That is still happening. Thank okay. you for asking all that. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we need to open our space to the public. We want to invite our community as promised. But we are going to be holding a series of stakeholder engagements. Mm-hmm. And our investor group is so near and dear to our heart. And they're an important part of what we have been able to accomplish. Okay. We couldn't have done this without them.
Excellent.
So we will be planning that. I think what's going to happen first is Independence Day, mm-hmm. Which is July 10th, as everybody knows that day. And while we have nothing to share with you officially today, our team is working behind the scenes to make something happen. We'll be publicizing
You'll
what we'll be doing.
You'll come back to tell us about that.
You know
yeah,
I will.
Okay.
You know I will.
All right.
And then after that, we're going to be looking at how we can showcase our space for our stakeholders and you know our Bahamian investors. But any investors that are listening to me right now, bring your family out and
they're listening.
And be proud of what you have accomplished, because this is quite an achievement. And we're so grateful as Bahamians to have what we think is the crowning jewel in the entire Caribbean, the best port in the region.
Very exciting times. Amanda Friedman, thank you so much for being with us this morning.
Thank
Looking
you for
forward
having
to
me.
This weekend and beyond, and having again another option for entertainment
thank
for all
you.
Of us. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Have a great weekend.
Thanks, you too.
I'll be back with more Morning Glen Business after this break. Stay with us here on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Earning zero interest on your savings at the bank? With as little as $100, you can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the CFAL Savings Express Plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
I'm Lasagna Mizek, Managing Director of RBC Royal Bank Bahamas, with some big news that will elevate your debit card experience. RBC's new Visa debit chip card will soon be here. To make things easier for you, we're offering free FedEx delivery when you validate your contact details. No need to wait in line. We'll bring the card straight to you. Call 356-8500. Select option 7 for Visa Debit Direct Line and update your delivery full weekdays between 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Take advantage of the security and convenience of chip and PIN technology. Free delivery is for a limited time, so act now.
Indulge in an experience that awakens your senses with Nescafe Gold. Premium Arabica coffee beans, carefully selected, roasted to perfection and finely ground. Results a match to flavor and aroma that captivates the senses. Enticing aroma, smooth taste. Elevate your coffee experience with Nescafe Gold.
Doctors Hospital has reimagined primary care. We have invested to improve our health system, ensuring that accessible, affordable, world-class clinical care is closer to you. We understand that your relationship with a primary care provider shapes the foundation of your overall health. Our new modern primary care facilities are where critical diagnoses and true personalized treatment begins. With locations across New Providence, Grand Bahama, and Exuma, we invite you to experience the Doctors Hospital difference. Book your next appointment at clinics.doctorshosp.com.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
My
My business couldn't survive without my credit card machine from Fidelity. It's fast, convenient, and my clients love it. My sales increased, and I can track my earnings. Get your credit card machine from Fidelity today. Call 356-7764.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
It is time for your morning business report brought to you by CFAL. Minister of Housing and Transport, Jo Beth Colby-Davis, who has responsibility for the post office, doing Family Island Banking through the Post Office Savings Bank. Modernizing that POSB has been on the government's agenda for some time now as a form of securing banking for residents on the Family Islands, where commercial banks in recent years have closed their brick-and-mortar operations. Colby-Davis telling Parliament this week that efforts to improve the operations on the Post Office Savings Bank will also be given significant attention in the upcoming budget period. You can read more about her comments in today's Guardian Business section. The Central Bank of the Bahamas is releasing a framework for commercial banks to have in place enterprise risk management moving forward. The central bank saying in a statement that the release of the guidance notes means supervised financial institutions, commercial banks, will be required to submit their enterprise-wide risk management assessments by September 30th. The guidance notes provide the industry with the central bank's minimum expectations when developing an ERM framework that enables the supervised financial institutions, the SFIs, to develop and implement strategies, policies, procedures, and controls to effectively manage risks. SFIs are encouraged to tailor their framework to align with the their nature, size, and complexity of their business and risk appetite. SFIs are expected to notify the central bank of any changes or deviation from their board-approved risk management framework as well. The central bank's guidance notes explain that the new protocol is also for cooperative credit unions, but does not apply to nominee trust companies or restricted trust companies that conduct business on behalf of a client or clients who are members of the same family. And the Tourism Development Corporation hoping to launch its business incubator pilot program by August. That's according to TDC Executive Director Ian Ferguson, who says that the corporation has right office space for the incubator in an area east of Bay Street and Rawson Square and has begun to put a plan together for the beautification of the areas east of East Street. Ferguson, making the remarks during yesterday's Office of the Prime Minister press briefing, said renovations have already begun on the space. He explained that the incubator will be a space for authentic Bahamian products. He reiterated that the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia has entered into a $10 million loan facility agreement with the government to fund the TDC's business incubation centers on New Providence, Grand Bahama, and Eleuthera. And he says it's not been yet finalized when the other incubators on the islands will be developed. Overseas, Canada's Senate has passed a bill that will require Google and Meta to pay media outlets for news content that they share or otherwise repurpose on their platforms. The bill, which is set to become law, was passed amid a standoff between Prime Minister Justin Trudeau's government and Silicon Valley tech giants. Ottawa has said the law creates a level playing field between online advertising giants and the shrinking news industry. And Canadian Heritage Minister Pablo Rodriguez has promised to push back on what he describes as threats from Facebook and Google to remove journalism from their platforms. Meta confirmed Thursday that it plans to comply with the bill by ending news availability on Facebook and Instagram for its Canadian users, as it had previously suggested. Meta would not offer details about the timeline for that move, but said it will pull local news from its site before the Online News Act takes effect. The bill will come into force 6 months after it receives royal assent. Market Watch recapping trading on the BSX from Thursday. Your market movers. Bank of the Bahamas moving 200 shares, closing at $4 unchanged. Cable Bahamas moving 12,900 unchanged at 415. Consolidated Water up 11 cents to 480. Emira Incorporated up 8 cents to $10.13. The BSX All Share Index closing at 2,551.60 unchanged. That's your Market Watch. And that is your morning business report brought to you by CFAL, growing wealth for future generations. We're back here with Morning Blend Business on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strong with you on this Friday morning. Got just a few minutes left in the show. A few of your text messages that we didn't get a chance to get to. We talking about a lot of different things this morning, including, of course, Municipal Government Week continues. And a great discussion today about Canada's system. And, I don't know if some of you are paying attention to what was going on. But anyway, let's read these messages. This person says here, when I was living in Canada, the number one problem I was faced with for public transportation was black ice on the road. It used to get so bad that the buses used to get stuck on the bus stops. Okay, thank you. Thank you for sharing that. My son lives in Canada. He's working, but every month he complains. And he says the only good thing is their health plan. Plus, the weather only allows him to work a few months in the year. Okay, these are two texts about Canada, not so much about government systems, but okay. Thank you. I hope that works out for him. This person, I read that text earlier from this person who said local government will lead to more taxes. The biggest issue is roads. Local government is not needed here, sir. Please just focus on making the present government do its damn job. What are they paid for? Let me give you a scenario. I hire someone to take care of my entire yard. He doesn't do his job. So what do? I hire someone else while still paying the first person. Does that make sense? Shouldn't I fire the first guy or stop paying him? Why pay extra money when it is not feasible? Read this, please. Texter. I don't know where to begin. It's unfortunate that I've started to read this 2 minutes before the end of the show. The people that you hired were hired to make sure that people don't invade your land and that there are laws in effect to protect whatever you want to do on your land, that you have the right to do that and that you don't violate the law. They weren't really hired to upkeep your land. Right, they were hired to make sure that you can do what you want to do on your land legally, or that they can prevent people from doing things illegally to your land, among other things. Now, if you feel that they should also be the people cutting the grass every week and planting the flowers and planting the trees and pruning them and decorating, if you feel that that's what they should do, that they things, right? And when there's a flood, come and get the water out of there. If you believe that's what that one person should do, well, then let's carry on smartly. Some of us don't believe that's what they should do. like the things I talked about earlier, that's what they should do, whereas somebody else comes who might actually have a degree in, or not, it doesn't matter, but in landscaping, that might be their thing, and they know what to do here and where and there and how to maximize the space, and so you can start to grow some, you know, vegetables in this part of the land that you have, but use this part here for recreation. I don't know, right? Different people to deal with that. But if you think it's one person who should do it all, well, that's what we've been doing. Tell me if it works. And we've been firing the people who don't take care of the land. We've been doing this. And we fire them, and then we hire somebody else to replace that person. And every 5 years, we've been doing this. But you think that works. You think it's just the person's the problem, not the system. I don't know. We'll see. This is just part two of the series. We've got more coming, and hopefully your eyes will be opened and you'll see the possibilities. That more government doesn't necessarily mean more problems. Just better management. Better management because people know what their role is and are not tasked with doing things that they shouldn't be doing because they have no experience. They don't know what in God's name to do. They don't have the ideas for it. But that's what we're doing here. This person says here, get people like me. I want to help promote local government for 20 years now. Hit me up. Okay. All right. Well, yeah. Well, as well, Rise Bahamas, and we hope to have them as part of this series as well, so you can hear what they're doing. And there is a petition. And so remember that. Go on to risebombs.net and sign that petition. And keep listening. Keep listening. We've got a whole lot more in this series to come. Want to thank Nahaja Black. Remember that name? She's up there in Canada and helped us greatly with finding that wonderful guest we had today, Alistair Mulling. And we really appreciate Nahaja for that this morning. All right. That's it for us today. We'll be back on Monday with more Morning Blend and Morning Blend Business right here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn, have a great day, everybody. Stay tuned for On the Clock with Aaron Green coming up next. Have a great weekend.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.